Conradie obtained her MBBCH in 1989, at a time when the prevalence of HIV infection was around 1%. In addition, HIV infection was a progressive illness that almost invariably resulted in death. In her career, she has seen the prevalence of HIV infection rise to over 30% in Gauteng province, where she works, and has been part of the research agenda that has brought effective antiretroviral therapy to over 1.9 million South Africans. Now, Dr. Conradie has turned her attention to TB research. She is involved in clinical trials of new strategies to the treatment of multidrug-resistant tuberculosis. It is her intention to bring the same innovative thinking that has saved countless South African lives from death due to AIDS to the TB field. I will now turn you over to Dr. Conradie. Thank you.
Good afternoon and good evening to everybody. I hope you can hear me well. I'm sitting in Johannesburg at the moment and we've just had a typical thunderstorm. So I hope that it doesn't interrupt our conversations at all. I'm going to talk about my experience with the new TB drug, Bedaquiline. And I'm going to just proceed with the conversation, with the lecture. I've never given a webinar before, so I hope it's okay. And then when we get to the end, I'll be answering your questions as we go along. So, most of us are familiar, those of us who are in the drug-resistant field, with this new drug that was registered for multidrug-resistant TB, Bedaquiline. This is when I encountered it for the first time, when I changed my research agenda from working with HIV to working within the MDR field. I started working in a unit where we were conducting this particular trial, the TMC, as it was so-called, TMC 207, 208 study. As I started to work on it, and I'm not going to present great amounts of detail on the action of Bedaquiline because I think we're familiar with it, but I think the slide that really tells a lot is the slide on when the curves on the Kaplan-Meier split out. So, as we know, the C208 study was a study where patients with MDR were randomized to treatment with the optimized background regimen plus placebo or active Bedaquiline. And in all the data sets, subjects completed week 72 or discontinued earlier. This slide is a slide showing the timeline of the study. So patients were given 24 weeks of either Bedaquiline, see there's a spelling error, or placebo, and then were followed up for a period of time thereafter. 282 subjects were enrolled from 15 different sites. South Africa enrolled at almost half of them, and 161 of them were randomized. But this, to me, was the result that really showed a difference between placebo and Bedaquiline. Being involved in the clinical trial, at that stage, we were blinded, needless to say, to the allocation of the treatment of the patient. However, both ourselves as the clinical researchers and the staff within the wards could tell pretty quickly whether the patients had been given active placebo or not by the fact that A, their culture converted faster, they put on weight faster, and we were often able to discharge them earlier. As a postscript to this, we were one of the sites that was inspected by the FDA. We passed with flying colors, there were no problems there. But when we were given the unblinding information, we were 100% correct as to patients, whether they were assigned to the active drug or the placebo. So this was my first encounter in a field that seemed to have been beset with poor outcomes, with treatment that resulted in people having permanent disability. And for me, it was the first light at the end of a rather dark tunnel. As a result of the success of the clinical trial, the National Department of Health was approached by Janssen Pharmaceutica to ask whether we would be interested, or whether the department would be interested in providing access to this drug prior to the registration of the drug, either by ourselves, our own medical control council, or whether or by any other authority. Based on the clinical trial results, we had a look at what would be the best way of providing access to patients. Of course, the most important thing when you're using a new and investigational agent is to make sure that the patients are protected, that their rights are protected as if they were on a research protocol. Needless to say, we also have to minimize the risk of treatment failure and the emergence of resistance. We have to make sure that there would be equitable access to the drug throughout South Africa, and we needed to comply with regulatory guidance. So we sat around the table, and with a group of partners, we formulated the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program. What we needed to do was we needed, in terms of patient protection, we needed to make sure that our patients were able to make autonomous decisions. And to do that, in order to be part of the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, we had an informed consent as part of the program. And the protocol itself was approved by all the research ethics committees to which the various facilities were regulated. Then we needed to make sure that we never added, as we know the old adage, for the treatment of any form of infection, that we never added a single drug to a failing regimen. And in order to make sure that we did that, we wanted to have our internal control, and we formulated the South African Clinical Advisory Committee. It was established by a number of experts who had treatment, who had experience in the treatment of drug resistance, and particularly extensively drug resistant TB. The committee still operates today, and it's a virtual committee that operates by email correspondence. Once we had approval for each individual patient, we then presented this information to Janssen, the company that manufactures Bedaquiline. In parallel to this, approval was obtained from our NCC, the Medicines Control Patient, on what's called a Section 21 or a named patient basis. The regulatory guidance that we followed is that the sites that were involved in the phase 2 clinical trials were approached first to conduct the compassionate use program. For those of you who are not familiar with South Africa, we have 9 provinces, and the original trials were only conducted in 2. In November 2011, we presented the protocol to our Medicines Control Council, and it was approved by the Medicines Control Council as a way to provide safe access to a new drug for patients with drug-resistant TB. In addition, they requested that we had an almost pseudo-clinical trial to monitor safety. The sponsor. I apologize for the inclement weather. There's very little that I can do about it. In collaboration with 2 NGOs, Right to Care, the organization that I work for, and MSF, a clinical access program was drafted, and it was approved finally in December 2012. What I'm going to now present is the early results of the National Clinical Access Program in South Africa. So our inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria is, first of all, we need laboratory confirmed either pre-XDR or XDR-TB. We accepted confirmation by either phenotypic or genotypic methods. Because the drug had only ever been used in patients who were above the age of 18, that was an inclusion criteria. In addition, we needed to construct a background regimen that had at least 3 drugs to which we either knew or we were relatively confident that the patient would not have resistance to. This was based either on results of DSTs or based on known treatment history. We required a negative pregnancy test in our female patients, and we prescribed contraceptive methods. Women who were pregnant or breastfeeding were excluded, and any unstable medical conditions also resulted in the patients being excluded. We had some blood requirements that were required for safety. Of importance was the fact that patients had to have pulmonary XDR or pre-XDR, so we needed to have a specimen result to prove that the patients had pulmonary TB. The patients who were enrolled on the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program received 400 milligrams of Bedaquiline once a day for 2 weeks, as is the standard, and then were given the 3 times a week 200 milligrams for 22 weeks, in addition to their background regimen of the second line drugs chosen to treat their particular XDR or pre-XDR. Very importantly, from both the national TB, from the Janssen and our regulatory authorities, is that we required the drugs that supported the Bedaquiline to be supplied by the national TB program. Our national TB program has a pretty much uninterrupted supply of drugs. So needless to say, we did not want to introduce this drug into a place where the drug would not be supported by adequate, good quality drugs. We had, in our original rollout of the BCAP, or the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, 12 sites were approved in South Africa, two of the heavy burden provinces. As it turned out, only 5 of the approved sites ended up enrolling patients. To date, through our Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, almost 230 patients have been granted access. And what I'm now going to show you is the 91 patients who were enrolled by the 15th of July. And this was data that was presented at last year's Barcelona Union Lung Conference. The data was centered at the end of August 2014. So to go back to the first slide, this is to show you where the sites were. There were 2 in the Western Cape, which is the highest burden TB area in South Africa and probably one of the highest in the world. There was my site, which is in Johannesburg, 1 in the Northwest Province, and 1 in KwaZulu-Natal, where the original Tugela Ferry outbreak was described. So, the patients who were enrolled on the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, so these were patients who were diagnosed and treated at the above sites. Their median age was just under 35 years. There was a slight predominance in males. In South Africa, as mentioned in my bio, the HIV seroprevalence is 30%, and enrolled onto the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, 2/3 of the patients were HIV infected. At the time, the median CD4 was 250, and we altered the antiretroviral therapy according to whether or not, according to what we could co-prescribe with the Bedaquiline. Although efavirenz is our first-line choice of non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, it cannot be co-prescribed with the Bedaquiline. So patients were either changed depending on their CD4 count and depending on whether they were successful antiretroviral therapy to a lopinavir or ritonavir-containing regimen, or to a nevirapine-containing regimen. And as you can see, 2/3 of our patients were given nevirapine who were HIV infected. If we have a look at the resistance patterns of patients who are on the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, a third of them were pre-XDR, or a third of them were full XDR. Just short of half of them were fluoroquinolone resistant, pre-XDR, and finally, the bulk of them were injectable resistant. I just need to take a quick about that. The optimized background regimen included clofazimine. It included lesolid, which was available in 70% of our sites, and levofloxacin was prescribed even in patients who are resistant to fluoroquinolone. So these are the results. In the 91 patients, at the time that we did the treatment lock, I'm speaking on the conference. I'm in the conference. Okay, so, yes. Call from the conference organizers. I just want to make sure that everybody can hear me clearly. If there's any problem, please let me know. We have a thunderstorm at the moment.
Yes, we were losing you a little bit, but now you're back on, so you can go on. We can hear you well.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So South Africa, the place where I live, is renowned for having very bad thunderstorms, and of course one has to now. But let's go back to the interim outcomes for our Bedaquiline clinical access program. At the time we had the treatment lock, 60% of our patients had completed Bedaquiline. 2%, two of the 60 did not complete it, either because they had died or we had a single patient who defaulted. And some patients had not completed at the time of our data lock. But as you can see, in a highly resistant group, the rate of culture conversion, if we add culture negative at start, because there was sometimes a bit of delay in accessing Bedaquiline, or culture converted, out of the 91, out of the 60 who started, just short of 47 had culture converted by the end of 6 weeks, by the end of 6 months, had confirmed culture conversion, which for this highly resistant group is very good news. If we have a look at them, we separated the patients out by whether they had drug-resistant TB that was resistant to both of the second lines, or resistant to either the aminoglycosides, or alternatively, it was resistant to the fluoroquinolones. We can see that there was very little difference in terms of the resistance patterns as to when their culture converted. And this is not a survival analysis, I beg your pardon. This is, in fact, an analysis by culture conversion. If we have a look at whether or not HIV status makes any difference, again, you can see that in a country where we have a good functioning antiretroviral program, whether a patient is HIV negative or positive, provided they have access to antiretroviral therapy and adherent to that, it makes no difference to the culture conversion rate if they're exposed to Bedaquiline. The big worry, as we all know with Bedaquiline, is the QTC prolongation. We had one patient that was withdrawn from treatment while being on Bedaquiline because she developed atrial fibrillation. And although it's atrial fibrillation and not ventricular, the patient was withdrawn for safety reasons. At the start, the median QTC of our 91 patients was 408, which is well within the normal limit. There was a mild but insignificant increase in the QTCF by the end of 2 months. Now, it's hard to say whether the fact that we removed many of our patients' moxifloxacin, which is a QTC prolonger, and substituted with another drug is the reason that we didn't see the increase. However, the bottom line is that we saw no unsafe increases in QTC. Two patients had a QTC that went above 500. Bedaquiline was withdrawn as per protocol, but in both of the cases, this QTC increase resolved within 24 hours. So it obviously was an aberration to do with the normal variation in QTC intervals. In terms of the safety database, at the time that we had the data lock, there had been reported of 3 deaths, so that's 3 out of 91 patients, and none of them were related to Bedaquiline. There were 3 reports of QTC prolongation and all resolved spontaneously. And for those of us who are in the MDR field, it doesn't come as a surprise that we had 3 serious adverse events that were of the neuropsychiatric nature. And all of them received tirzepatide, and we felt that the neuropsychiatric disturbance was related more to the tirzepatide than to anything else. So in conclusion, in the sites that enrolled patients, we had really good outcomes in a very extensive population. We have begun to extend to the other sites, bringing it to the total of 12 sites that are now able to enroll. And the very good news for us was the fact that Bedaquiline was registered in South Africa in October 2014. So then the next thing that we had to grapple with in South Africa was, how do we go about introducing new drugs into our national TB program into our national TB program safely and effectively, allowing our patients the best access to treatment therapy, and then protecting both the patients and the drug itself. So again, we put together a consortium of people, a number of experts in the MDR field, and we formulated a framework for the introduction of new drugs into our national program. So as I'm sure most of you are well familiar, the WHO recommends that as a prerequisite for the introduction of new or repurposed drugs, we need to have a national implementation plan. This cannot be done ad hoc by people who think that they know what they're doing. We need to monitor and evaluate the new drugs and the regimen, with close attention being paid to pharmacovigilance. We do need some form of private sector involvement, and in this case, the private and sector involvement was from a number of NGOs. We need to make sure that if we are putting a new drug into a national program, that we have uninterrupted supply of quality shared drugs. As we know, the current regimen for MDR is not based on randomized controlled clinical trials, but it is based on expert opinion. So while we are waiting for the randomized controlled clinical trials, then we need to conduct operational research on the programs that we are currently doing. So, in the formulation of our national framework for the introduction of new drugs and for the management of DRTB, we wanted to ensure the appropriate selection of the patients for the new drugs, the regimens and management. We wanted to ensure that the patients were effectively managed, whether they were either recently or previously diagnosed as drug-resistant TB. We wanted to ensure that there was appropriate monitoring and managing pharmacovigilance. And finally, we wanted to provide oversight and management from the national level, as well as implementation from the various provincial and district levels. So as it currently stands, with Bedaquiline now being registered in South Africa, who is eligible for access for Bedaquiline in a national TB program? Please note that people who are not, Bedaquiline is only available through the national TB program and cannot be purchased from a private pharmacy in South Africa. The first thing that we said is that patients can be provided with the drug provided they are above the age of 18. In contrast to the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, we look for resistance to rifampicin based on either phenotypic or genotypic assays. And in addition to that, we're not only looking, despite the fact that Bedaquiline is registered for the treatment of pulmonary TB, we agree that patients with extra pulmonary TB should be allowed access to Bedaquiline. We ask if the patient has any history of a QTC prolonging or any family history, and that would exclude the patient if that is present. I have never seen that. In addition to that, in addition to rifampicin resistance, all patients who are diagnosed as either XDR or pre-XDR will be offered access to Bedaquiline. There is a small case series that shows that patients with both the INHA and CAPG mutation are likely to have XDR-TB, so we've allowed access for those patients. In addition, patients with both these mutations have neither the option of INH or ethionamide, and adding a third a drug to the regimen in terms of Bedaquiline would be useful. Then the most exciting thing in my mind is that if we have documented recorded intolerance to the second-line anti-TB treatment at baseline or during treatment, and we all know that the most serious complication of the treatment of drug-resistant TB is hearing loss. So if patients either enter the program with compromised hearing or develop, and I will show you the schema that we're going to use to grade this, develop hearing loss during the treatment for drug-resistant TB, they will be offered bedaquiline, and we may add another drug depending when during the program, when during the treatment they develop it. In addition, patients who can no longer be provided with the injectable because of the development of renal dysfunction will be offered bedaquiline, and there are some other adverse drug reactions that we would like to substitute bedaquiline for, particularly neuropsychiatric dysfunction as a result of tirzepatide, ethionamide, and the quinolones. So that is at a local level. So clinicians at approved sites, so sites that are approved to prescribe bedaquiline, if the patients fulfill any of those criteria, can automatically get access to bedaquiline. However, as I mentioned before, we have a national review committee that will look at cases that need to go a little bit higher, and we need to apply our minds a little bit more. So patients who have had more than 3 months of pre-XDR or XDR treatment will be reviewed at a national level, and we will decide whether or not it is appropriate to add bedaquiline to their regimen. And then patients that have had who have fewer than two of the following, and I'll show you in a second, of the drugs counted in the regimen. So if they don't have two drugs, then we ask that the clinicians refer it to the national level so that the patients can be, so that we can decide at a national level whether this is in the best interest of the patients and in public health. So in terms of the injectables, if the patient has a susceptibility test that shows susceptibility to the injectables within the last 3 months, we consider those to be susceptible. We only count a quinolone if the patient is susceptible to ofloxacin in the last 3 months. Bedaquiline would be one of the drugs that we need to add to the regimen. And we also will look at whether the patient's been exposed to linezolid for a prolonged period of time before adding bedaquiline. Okay, so the national committee will review all of the patients who do not fulfill the criteria. So the first thing is that if they do not have at least one drug to which their TB is susceptible or predicted to be susceptible, they need to be reviewed by the national committee. For people who are under the age of 18, although we are well aware that the trials were conducted in adults only, if we have a patient under the age of 18, then we ask that the clinicians refer it to the national committee. I think that a 17-year-old, there is no reason to suspect that the pharmacodynamics and kinetics would be any different based on their age. If we have a pregnant woman who is diagnosed with either XDR or pre-XDR, we ask that this patient be referred to the national committee to decide whether the risk-benefit ratio is in favor of prescribing bedaquiline. And patients who have had MDR-TB treatment, which is defined by our program as a smear or culture positive 8 months into MDR-TB treatment, without any proven resistance to second line, be referred to the national program. Now, I want to make it very clear that referring to the national program, national committee, does not mean that the patient will not get the drug. It just means that we have a further layer to ensure that the regulatory and safety guidance are adhered to. So what are the contraindications? Of course, any patient that refuses consent for bedaquiline or MDR-TB treatment is a contraindication. If the patient is at high risk for cardiac complications, and the truth is that I'm not sure that the risks of cardiac complications are higher than the risk of acquiring XDR. And then, just to cover everything, anyone who's had a history of a severe reaction to bedaquiline would also have a contraindication. So this is how we have decided to grade ototoxicity. We have a portable audiometric system in South Africa called CliDiWave, which means that patients who are prescribed anti-TB treatment should, of course, have their hearing done before and hearing tested before initiation of therapy, at every month thereafter during the time of injectables, and at least once thereafter. If the patient develops a 20 decibel loss in one frequency, that is considered to be grade 1 hearing loss, and the patient will be considered for bedaquiline. If it's a 10 decibel loss in two adjacent frequencies, again, this will be considered as a development of ototoxicity. If patients have decreased hearing prior to starting therapy, then we would consider prescribing bedaquiline de novo as opposed to exposing them to potential disability by adding an injectable. If the patient develops hearing loss in the first month or two, which is the classical time when hearing loss develops, we would do a single drug substitution. So we would remove the injectable and replace it with bedaquiline. Of course, if the patient is a little bit further on in treatment and has not yet culture converted, then we would add bedaquiline and lanreotide to make sure that we were not adding a single drug to a potentially failing regimen. So relative contraindications is because there are very few treatment options for patients, there are very few treatment contraindications. We would also say that we should not be prescribing QTC prolonging medications. And the drugs that we have paid particular close attention to is many patients who are HIV infected have peripheral neuropathy, and almost historically, triptanol or amitriptyline is co-prescribed. This is a powerful QTC prolonger, and if a patient does have a need for those drugs, we would have to weigh up swapping out that drug and changing it to another drug for peripheral neuropathy. Haloperidol is not an uncommonly co-prescribed drug because of the relative large amount of neuropsychiatric adverse events. Again, this is contraindicated with the prescription of bedaquiline. Our advice for women who are breastfeeding, that if they develop a culture positive XDR, pre-XDR, or MDR, that we would suggest the cessation of breastfeeding in order to protect the infant, but that is a relative contraindication. Because two-thirds of our patients are HIV infected in South Africa, we need to ensure that our patients have adequate antiretroviral therapy. For patients who are initiating antiretroviral therapy during bedaquiline, if their CD4 count is less than 250 in females and less than 350 in males, we would consider the use of a nevirapine. Raltegravir is available in South Africa, but is only available for third line, but it's possible we could add that because there are no putative drug-drug interactions with raltegravir. The lopinavir/ritonavir is a second-line drug, and we would also consider that. Rilpivirine, the second-generation non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor, has recently been registered in South Africa and has no contraindications with bedaquiline, and that would be one of our four options. It's important that we provide access to our patients for adequate antiretroviral therapy, otherwise they are unlikely to survive the MDR episode. And we need to tailor our antiretroviral treatment to fit in with bedaquiline as opposed to vice versa. So what are we going to do to ensure that our patients are safely managed? We have a protocol for the management of patients, including the testing of renal function, hearing, liver functions, for as long as the patients are on ethionamide and PZA. So we would follow those as routine. In addition, we would require that an ECG is done prior to starting bedaquiline. And then if the patient is going to be given either moxifloxacin or clofazimine, weekly ECG should be done for the first month to ensure that there is no there's not too much of an increase in the QTC interval. How are we going to manage antiretroviral therapy? I think I covered that when we talked before. We just need to fit in our antiretroviral therapy options. In the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program, we swap patients' antiretroviral therapy to fit in with the Bedaquiline, and then we transferred it back without any adverse events, and patients maintain their virological suppression. And finally, how are we going to monitor resistance in patients who are on Bedaquiline? At this stage, there is no validated method. However, Janssen has done some work on it, and our National Health Laboratory Services, NHLS, will begin to provide the service for as soon as patients are enrolled onto the program. So what we will do is patients who are enrolled onto the Bedaquiline program, so this is no longer compassionate access, but part of our routine work, we will take a sputum for culture at the beginning, at the outset, and then at 2 and 6 months, the vast majority of which will be negative. During this period, the selected laboratories will test 3 concentrations of Bedaquiline, as demonstrated by the slide. If any of the isolates with an MIC of greater than 0.25 will be sent to the National TB Laboratory, and this will be confirmed. However, we will not suggest, until we have further clarity on the implications of this, we would not consider interrupting Bedaquiline unless there are safety reasons, because there still needs to be some in vivo and in vitro work on Bedaquiline resistance. So in conclusion, South African patients were given access to Bedaquiline prior to its registration, both by a local authority, the NCC, and by the FDA. This was conducted safely with a high rate of culture conversion. We are still waiting for the long-term, for the 2 and 3 year outcome, but this certainly is a hopeful way forward. And the national framework that we formulated is the best way that we can think in a pragmatic way to introduce new drugs into our national TB program until randomized controlled clinical data is available on the best MDR regimen.
Thank you so much, Dr. Conradie. Thank you so much. I have a few questions, so I will let you have a moment to look at them, and please repeat them when you are answering, because other participants have the questions.
The first question was, why did the remaining sites, the 7 out of 12 sites, not end up enrolling Bedaquiline patients? So the patient, our country is widely diverse. We have big rural areas where there are very few patients, and we have concentrated urban areas where there are a lot of patients. So it's really dependent on the burden of that the facilities were exposed to. We trained up the doctors, but they didn't see patients that would require Bedaquiline in the period that we had the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program. It took a lot of capacitation, and it ended up that 7 out of the 12 ended up enrolling patients onto the Bedaquiline Clinical Access Program. The next question is, if pregnant women is diagnosed with XDR, can we start Bedaquiline postpartum? Of course, this is it's a question that we face in the treatment of pregnant women in anything. If we look at a retrospective study that was conducted in South Africa about the outcomes of XDR, only 15% of our patients had a favorable outcome. And you put that against a pregnant woman and the potential exposure to Bedaquiline, I think it needs to be taken on an individual patient basis. In terms of exposure to the injectables, we know that there are some potential side effects of the injectables, and we're not sure which way it's going to go. This is why we have decided in South Africa that should a pregnant woman require access to Bedaquiline, it requires national review, so that we can weigh it up amongst a group of experts. However, I do think that the risks of XDR are much greater to a pregnant woman than the risks of Bedaquiline. I may well be wrong. Then the next question is, if a patient has a QTC greater than 450, but a resistance profile requiring bedaquiline, can we start? If so, to what QTC can we consider starting? So a normal, the upper limit of normal for a QTC is 450 for women and 750 for men. And again, we are running the parallel risks of the concern about developing a ventricular tachycardia that may end up in a fatal arrhythmia with the concept that many of our patients will die as a result of their MDR-TB. In all the time that I have been doing research in drug-resistant TB, I have not yet found a patient who has a QTC above 450. So I think, but again, it has to be taken on a case-by-case basis. I think if the patient does have a QTC above 450, I would have a very careful look that there were no other medications that were causing that before I would consider prescribing the drug. In terms of, then the next question says that a QTC resolved, I mentioned that two patients on our bedaquiline clinical access program had QTCs above 500 and that it resolved within 24 hours. So the question says, does that mean that one does not stop bedaquiline immediately when one notices a QTC prolongation? The truth is we stopped the bedaquiline mainly because it was mandated by the protocol, but not because it makes any physiological sense. Bedaquiline has an exceptionally long half-life, so stopping the dose early on is not really going to make a difference. There is a variability of 40 to 60 within a QTC in a normal day. So we could easily be catching someone whose QTC normally runs at 420, going up to 480. We would consider that to be an adverse event, but it may well be within the normal variations of QTC. I guess to really closely monitor this, we would need to be doing Holter monitoring. So we need to be monitoring our patients over a 24-hour period. But in both of the cases, because the increase in QTC resolved so quickly, we were not concerned with the increase. Okay, then at the next question is around whether the HIV status on our clinical access program had any effect on the culture conversion and adverse events. In the slide that I showed early on, is that the culture conversion was the same irrespective of HIV status. In terms of adverse events, we only monitored serious adverse events, and there was, because there were so few serious adverse events, it's difficult to say whether it was related to HIV or not. There are overlapping toxicities between antiretroviral therapy and anti-TB medicines, and we are very cognizant in this in South Africa, but there is no great increase in adverse events associated with being HIV infected. Okay, then the next question is, please clarify, is RIF resistance adequate alone for eligibility, or do the patients have to have additional resistance? And we're now talking about not the bedaquiline clinical access program, but how we want to introduce the program into, how we want to introduce bedaquiline into our national program. So as the very bare minimum, you need RIF resistance. And then in order to qualify for bedaquiline, you need either more extensive resistance or treatment-limiting toxicity. So it's one or the other. We have done predictions on the number of patients that would require bedaquiline access in South Africa, and we estimate it to be a combination of extensive resistance, which accounts for 500 of our 10,000 cases, pre-XDR, which is about another 1,500, and then about 20% patients will develop treatment-limiting toxicity. So as a kind of a back of the envelope, we've estimated that about 3,000 South Africans will be eligible for access to bedaquiline in our next year. So just to stress again, it's more extensive resistance or intolerance to therapy. Just reading the questions as they're coming out, so they're a little bit back to forward, so please just bear with me. The next question is, what was the cause of death of the three patients on bedaquiline, given the disproportionate distribution of deaths in the patients on the phase two trial? There were the causes of death. The first patient who died on the program died, unfortunately, as a result of the suicide. She was developed a psychiatric or psychosis during her initial phase. Her intensive phase was appropriately treated, then was discharged home, went to a different province, and unfortunately she committed suicide. The second one, a patient developed a very clear history of a pulmonary embolism. She traveled, she was in a minibus taxi, and she developed a pulmonary embolism, and that was her cause of death. And the last one was a patient who just didn't culture convert, so had progressive TB. So of the three deaths to date, there is no indication of a sudden cardiac death, the kind of death that is in keeping with the mortality imbalance within the phase three trials. And I have the next question that's coming up. I was sincerely hoping that nobody would ask, but here it is anyway. The next question is, define high risk for cardiac complications as an exclusion criteria. Well, a congenital prolonged QTC interval would be one of those. Again, I've never seen that. I suppose somebody with unstable coronary artery disease or unstable valvular disease would be considered to be a contraindication. But again, I think if there's any doubt about that, we would ask that the clinicians refer the patient's details to the clinical national clinical team, and we would weigh up the risk-benefit ratio. So that was the next question. At which time points is the following question. At which time points will bedaquiline resistance be tested? It will be, so if the patient is enrolled onto the national program, the initial isolate will be sent to the National TB Reference Lab. We will also send a culture again at 2 months and again at 6 months. So it doesn't matter whether they convert or not, we'll send it to the National TB Reference Lab, making sure that we're not losing any specimens. I would imagine, well, from our previous experience with bedaquiline, the vast majority of patients will convert by day 56, so the second month culture will already be negative. But we will test it, and then should the patient have a relapse following bedaquiline treatment, it will be, again be sent to the National TB Lab to keep a close eye on the development of resistance to the new drug. So then the next question is, DST done on solid medium, I presume. Are you working on methods for liquid media? In fact, it will be done, as far as I know, and I'm not a laboratory person, it will be done in liquid medium, not in solid. But I will have to refer that question to the National TB Reference Laboratory. So again, we are trying to ensure as much as possible that as we introduce a new strategy in our MDR or our drug resistance program, that we are making sure that the development of resistance is closely watched. Then I've got two more questions. The first one is, what about patients that are prescribed with bedaquiline where exposure to second-line injectables is more than 30 days without having access to pain second-line? Not sure I understand the question. So if the patient has been exposed to more than 30, so if the patient has had more than 30 days of second-line and we have no access, would we just add bedaquiline? The answer to that is no. And I think it's difficult to answer this one correctly, because we A, have access to second lines, and we would be able to diagnose it. So I see another question is coming. What about using bedaquiline in XDR failures? Well, we already in our bedaquiline clinical access program, we have, if we cannot back our XDR failures up with other drugs, and in our case it would be linezolid and clofazimine, we would not provide access to that patient. The concept of having patients walking around with drugs, with an organism that is resistant to bedaquiline and everything else, we have to weigh up the individual patient benefit against the public health benefit. So we have refused patients with XDR failure. So the next question is, what's the best antiemetic to use? either odanthotron. So odanthotron is a QTc prolonging drug. Well, I don't have much experience with using odanthotron because we don't have it available commonly. We tend to use metoclopramide for what it's worth. We try to split the drugs if at all possible. So we find that if we split PZA, if we split ethionamide, it tends to help. But we tend to use lesser drugs than odanthotron. I'm afraid that's just the reality of our program. Has bedaquiline been, this says it's the last question, but it's the second last question. Has bedaquiline been used in pediatric TB cases? The answer to that one is no. Various groups are looking at the pediatric registration for bedaquiline, but it hasn't been used. And then finally, what advice would you give to other countries considering introducing bedaquiline? Okay, here we go. Here's my opinion. The first thing is that we need to make sure that countries that are considering introducing bedaquiline into their program for drug-resistant TB have uninterruptible supplies of currently registered drugs for patients. So we can't introduce bedaquiline in a program where the program is not functioning well. We need support from the national TB program. I do not think that private practitioners operating on their own should be allowed to prescribe bedaquiline for the fear that resistance will develop as a result of adding a single drug to a broken system. I think that we need to be very cognizant of safety, although I think that the safety signal we saw in the phase 2 trial was in fact a statistical aberration. So I think in terms of safety, I'm not as concerned about safety of the individual as I'm concerned, and I'm putting it in inverted commas, as the safety of the drug. We need to make sure that the drug is backed up by adequate drugs for the treatment of drug-resistant TB. Any further questions?
There's one more question that just came up, so that would be the last question that we'll take, and we only have 5 minutes left. Thank you.
Okay. The question is, my experience of using bedaquiline in female gender, as literature suggests, there are increased episodes of QTc prolongation. Well, first of all, the cutoff for men and women is slightly different. The cutoff for the upper limit of normal in men is 450 and 470 in women. We didn't see an increase in gender-based QTCs as a result of the introduction of bedaquiline. So I think it wouldn't really concern me. I would prescribe bedaquiline to women as easily as I would to men without being concerned about. Any further
great,
questions?
Thank you.
Great.
Dr.
Conradie,
thanks. We're out of time. So I wanted to thank you very much for this excellent